Next, as we promised you earlier on, this is Meet Me in the Bathroom in Search of the Strokes. This is the story. This is the scenario. I'll paint the picture for you. It was back in January of this year that we set out to try and infiltrate the Strokes camp to find out what life was really like inside the bubble of what I guess arguably one of the most hyped bands on the planet. 6 months, hundreds of phone calls and several near nervous breakdowns later, the station's intrepid hack, you know him as Danny O'Connor, finally hit pay dirt as the band prepared to play two homecoming shows in New York City in the summer. So, for the first time, all five Strokes shooting from the hip, both alone and together. It's 2002's Kings of Cool on their past, the present and the future, including an exclusive interview with their behind-the-scenes guru.
Are you ready to make it happen?
1-3-2-4-6 K-Rock, win tickets to see Strokes and Strength.
Here we are playing Radio City Music Hall, one of the most famous venues, if not in New York, out in the world, you know?
It's been around since Sinatra's times, you know what I mean? And I think it sold out in like 6 minutes.
There's no doubt they identify with New York. They're products of New York.
That it sold out, that means a lot to us. That many people, after those years, want to come see us.
Get together and just, you know, like,
what the,
you know, we like sort of celebrate all these things that are happening.
The White Stripes and the Strokes, so I think the two of them coming together is really quite a special moment in rock and roll history.
It's unreal, it's true.
It's Monday, August the 12th, 2002, and I'm standing here on the corner of 6th Avenue and 51st Street on Manhattan, outside the world-famous Radio City Music Hall. In 3 days' time, the Strokes will take to the stage inside in front of 6,000 fans for arguably the most prestigious show of their career, putting the final touches to a rollercoaster 12 months. In keeping, the band have become notoriously media-shy, and an interview is about as easy as an audience with the Pope. That said, they have agreed to talk to me, or should I say, they agreed to talk to me. That was until this morning.
Hey.
Hi, it's Danny here from Radio 1.
Oh, hi. I'm really glad you called. We're having problems, I'm afraid. I'm really sorry about this, but the guys are locked in rehearsals for the Radio City show, so it's not looking too good because they're up against it.
So here I am, baking in 102 degrees of midsummer madness. Anyway, the show in a few days also features the White Stripes, and thank God Jack White has said yes to an interview.
My name's Jack White, and we're at Radio City Music Hall. I've been thinking
of a little place down by the lake. And this sounds like one of those great sort of bar conversations that actually becomes a reality.
It's exactly what it was. We were hanging out with the Strokes in Leeds who came to see their show while we were in England, because we hadn't seen them yet, and we just got on really well with them. It was their idea, you know, let's do some shows together. You know, try not to exploit it very much, let's just do it because it's a cool thing to do.
I suppose in a way there's a lot of shared experience there as well over maybe the last year.
We've both had, you know, massive amounts of press in Britain and been called, you know, whatever, the next new thing or whatever it is in America and England and things like that. And it has been like that. It's a sort of press calling, you know, some sort of, you know, rock and roll revolution or something. So yeah, we have a lot of experiences. So when I read interviews with them or I talk to them, you know, a lot of the same stories, you know, that we've had for the last year or so.
And that rock and roll revolution started taking shape at the cafes and bars in Manhattan's Lower East Side late in 1998. So, with no band to talk to just yet, time to track down some of their mates. Steve sings with Longwave, another New York band who have supported the Strokes on many occasions.
I guess objectively, there really are a lot of good bands in New York right now. That's pretty exciting. We like to say that, you know, we don't feel as though we're musically related in any way to a lot of these bands, but the reality of it is there just are a lot of really great bands right now. I guess in that way, it's a really good place to be.
This is Nick. I play guitar with the AAS. We, you know, owe a lot to the Strokes or so, just for opening a lot of doors, for putting the spotlight back on New York where it belongs. There are a lot of great bands in New York. I mean, unfortunately, a lot of the mediocre bands are also getting some attention, which, you know, maybe just sort of like a feeding frenzy thing. But it's an exciting time now.
My name is Steve. I'm a bartender at Mumbles. It's a neighborhood restaurant in Manhattan.
So tell me the connection with this place and the Strokes.
Well, these guys have come in here before they were even recording, and then while they were recording. And they're a good bunch of guys, and I met them as guys before I heard a note of their music.
Tell me about sort of some of the stories that have come across the bar.
Well, the one that comes to mind is when, before the CD was released here in the States, Julian was in having a bite to eat. I knew that he had been in the studio and asked him what's going on with the record, is it coming out? And casually he added it, oh, we released it in England. Yeah, we debuted at number one. I said, what? He repeated himself, and I just said, dude, I'd be out in the streets dancing right now. He was so laid back about it. I couldn't believe it was a number one record in England. And he was just unbelievably casual for a new artist. It was pretty funny.
Tuesday, August the 13th, 6 p.m. It's that woman again.
Danny, hi. Listen, good news. Albert's got a half hour over breakfast tomorrow. You want to go meet him at the cafe called Mumbles on First? You know it, right? You were talking to Steve.
Bingo. Wednesday, August the 14th, 10 a.m.
I'm Albert Hammond, Jr., and we're at Mumbles, a couple blocks from my house on 3rd Avenue and 17th Street.
And it's a momentous time, really, to be catching up with you. Do you get philosophical at these kind of times and see these as little commas or stop-off points in the context of what's happened so far?
I usually get that way once they've passed, you know? Like, probably a month past it, you know, I'll look back and be like, wow, I can't believe we did that, or we're going to do this, you know? While it's happening, you just have to... You can't think so much, you got to feel it. I mean, Radio City is like, I don't know what the same thing would be in England, but it's like a well-known, established place. It's been around, you know, since Sinatra's times, you know what I mean? It's like where the Rockettes, you know, do their Christmas thing, and like, or just really big people have played. It's our biggest hometown show. I think it sold out in like 6 minutes. We thought, let's make it like an event. Like, you know, like just we have these two bands, you know, and we'll just go in there and people will like feel like it's an event. You know, it feels special even before the music started. So imagine how they're going to feel once the music starts, you know?
How easy or otherwise is it going on after the White Stripes?
For us, it's for both bands. It's not a competition. It's not easy or hard. It's fun. You know, we're both really friendly with each other. Like in Detroit, we went on before them and they went after us. And it was like, it's a very friendly backstage. Whatever the crowds might think, you know, like weird vibes, it's amazing back there. It's more like, you know, good luck, have a great show. Like we see them, they see us. You know, it's about making the night, not really about trying to beat anyone. We both respect each other for the different things that we're doing. Our set list is 15 or 16 songs. One of the new ones is not ready for stage yet. You know, sometimes we'll play a song when it's totally not ready just to feel what the crowd is getting so that we can kind of change it up, but this isn't quite there yet.
So can you give me titles?
Yes, The Way It Is, You Talk Way Too Much, Zanui, which still doesn't have a title, Meet Me in the Bathroom, and one called I Can't Win.
2 hours later.
Hiya, Danny. Julian's going to be at the bar called the International Bar. It's close to the Bowery, right near to our offices. Do you know it?
I do.
My name is Julian. Right now we're at a bar downtown in New York.
Do you get to a stage, you know, when you're about to do these shows where you pause and attempt to take stock of what's gone on, or is it just all happening and you'll kind of have a think about it in a few years?
As fast as it's been going, it's still been at a pretty steady pace since the beginning. It hasn't been like overnight, you know, nobody knows this and then all of a sudden we're these like platinum selling artists. I mean, it seems like it just gradually happens, you know. Started when we first played in front of nobody, and then more people are coming, then you're playing bigger shows, then you're going out of town, then you're going overseas and the shows get bigger there. So it just seems to grow pretty steadily. I mean, rapidly, but steadily. Don't get me wrong, probably every other day, you know, we all get together and just, you know, it's like, what the? You know, we like sort of celebrate all these things that are happening. It's unreal, it's true. It's hard to gauge it when you're inside the bubble. I think still a lot of people don't know us, and that's just sort of how we look at it for some reason.
It's the morning of the big day. Tonight, the Strokes will follow in the footsteps of Frank Sinatra and Tony Bennett and bask in the sheer opulence of Radio City.
Hi, Danny. Listen, why don't you come down to the venue at lunchtime before they sound check? We'll see if Nikolai and Fab have got some time for you then.
My name is Fab. I'm the drummer. I guess this is like a backstage area in Radio City Music Hall. I woke up at around 1 o'clock in the afternoon because we had just played a show last night. I went to meet Nick, had some breakfast, Luckily, they still serve breakfast out in restaurants in the East Village at that time. Met up with Nikolai at the office. Nick and I went to pick up Julian and Albert. Came here, sat around for a little bit, smoked some cigarettes, talked about last night. Then we were called down to the stage where everything was nicely set up. Shit our pants. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm not supposed to say that. Got very scared when we saw the immensity of this place. And the closer it gets to showtime, the more my fingers start to shake. And I
Nikolai, we're in the backstage of Radio City Music Hall. We're pretty nervous. We spent a lot of time thinking, just hanging out, all five of us, you know, with the friends and stuff, and just thinking about the show, especially this one, which is so massive, and, you know, so we just pretty much lounge around, and your nerves are just relaxed, and it's kind of, it switches to an excitement more than nervousness.
If there's a progression that involves New York venues and winds up here, because you must have played pretty much everywhere on Manhattan. Quickly rattle through them for me.
It's not like these places are strategically put so that it makes it easier for you to travel from one place to another physically, but it's like, you know, down in the East Village, West Village too, like, pretty much down there, there's a bunch of places, small bars and stuff, and you go and you try to sort of insert yourself into the routine of that, CBGB's, Mercury Lounge, Bowery Ballroom, all those places. And I guess you get sort of bigger there. You get down there, there's like the difference between one place, like the Luna Lounge, which is like 200 people. You still have down there the Bowery Ballroom, which is like 600, I think, something like that. As you go more uptown, I guess people uptown have more money so they can build bigger places or something. Like you got Irving Plaza, which is about 1,600 or something. And then you come to Midtown where all the rich people walk around with their dogs and fluffy fur coats and they have the capacity to build something like this, like Radio City Music Hall. The bummer is, though, that with their sort of elitist way, most of the shows here pretty much suck. They have to wait for the White Stripes to come and co-revolutionize the rock and roll scene with the Strokes. I don't know what I'm talking about right now. I'm totally kidding, by the way. We started playing these places, headlining these shows, crazy, massive shows, or at least to us, like 600 people or something like that. And then, I guess, like, the elite rock and roll stars and the hipsters out there were like, these guys are cool. And we were like, damn right we're cool. We were trying to tell you that, like, 5 months ago. Hey, I'm Fab from The Strokes, and you're listening to The Strokes on Radio 1.
The road to Radio City, as Fab was saying, is long and winding, certainly when you're driving from the Lower East Side. But the Strokes story proper starts uptown at the Dwight School on 89th Street and Central Park West. It was here in the early 90s that Julian Casablancas, Fabrizio Moretti and Nick Valensi met, as Nick explains.
I really needed people, like-minded kids, to play music with.
So at that stage it was just after school or whatever?
That's exactly what it was.
At home.
Yeah, after school, usually in Julian's bedroom, sometimes in Fab's bedroom too. Not so much at my house, because my mom was sort of a pain in the ass about smoking in the apartment. Well, Nikolai, at the time, was, you know, great friends with Julian, because they were raised together. They knew each other since they were in grammar school, you know?
When I graduated high school, my step-grandmother bought me a bass. One day I just picked it up, and I felt like being very serious about it, and I liked it a lot, and I started playing much more and avidly.
With Nikolai on board, the four-piece went in search of the missing link. Here's Nick again.
We went through actually a bunch of different people who we would just invite over to see if it would work out, and it never really did. And that was frustrating because we were sort of a band, but we couldn't really go play shows or really, you know, do anything because we were missing a member. As luck would have it, a simple twist of fate, Albert Hammond Jr. flies in from LAX. He like somehow knew Julian. A year before I met Julian, they had gone to this Swiss boarding school together.
Albert Hammond Jr.
And I ran into him on the street 7 years after I met him, barely in boarding school, like nothing. We weren't like best friends, we just knew of each other. He'll probably tell you better than I would, but I was like really little kid, little cute boy, you know. I wasn't like a man at all. And when he saw me, I was like a man, you know. I had like big curly hair, you know. I had like a slight beard, and like I was dressed different. He just, you know, he was shocked.
He showed up and he played guitar well, and it fit in perfectly with what we were doing. And he had a great sense of style, and he had a certain wit about him.
And I just went into the studio. I met everyone. I had like 102 fever the first time I met them, and they got me drunk, which I'd never really gotten. And I was just like so nervous that they weren't going to want me. And I left, and I thought, like, that's it. I'm not going to be in the band.
It wasn't even like an audition or whatever. It was just the first time we played with Albert, and right from then, everybody just knew. It fit. I didn't take no
shortcuts. And they called me like, yeah, man, let's keep on playing. And then from then on, we just focused and became really serious. You know, everyone got more focused once they knew, like, wow, shit, we have a band.
So what sort of noises were you making at this stage?
The songs were weird. They were like lame, sort of epic songs. They weren't very good. A lot of Queen-type guitar solos, a lot of Brian May guitar solos. I'd say about 3 or 4 months after that is when we came up with the name.
Nikolai again.
We got all these songs, and we were playing, we were ready to play shows, and we didn't have a name, so we would have homework. We would go home, like every time we would meet, we would come back with a list of names, you know? And they were terrible, terrible names.
Really, just sitting around, and Julian blurted it out. It was really just an organic way, I guess, to come up with a name. But it was really the first one that everybody agreed on. It was like, yeah, that sounds cool, so we kept it.
Julian Casablancas.
Once we really started thinking about it, you know, early on in the early days, you know, we said everyone comes to New York to make it, you know, and we live here. It's like, let's just do it here, you know, and then move on. So we definitely focused here first. I mean, we still do these shows like here and there. It just makes us feel good, I think.
After recording the demo, ourselves, we knew, wow, this is, you know, I remember John saying this will get us signed, you know.
The only goal was having good songs, doing something that had quality, and that was it, you know. Everything else I didn't really care about.
Ryan and Jeff Travis for us are the beginning of it all, you know. When we met Ryan, he proposed doing residency at Mercury Lounge. That's when many more people began to come and see us.
Ryan Chantels, I'm the manager of the Strokes. They were just amazing. The demo that they sent me was great. And when I saw them play, I booked them the first show and saw them play, I knew that they were special, you know? Not just that, but they worked extremely hard for themselves. Everywhere I would go, I would see one of the Strokes handing out a flyer for a show, you know, on the corners, at bars, at clubs, everywhere I'd see them, you know, always promoting themselves, always working really hard, doing their legwork, you know? And they had a real plan. They had an idea. They had a vision. They weren't just like, help us, we don't know. They were like, all right, we want to do this, we want to do this, we want to do this, and we have a plan, we want to do it like this, like this, like this. Like, can you help us?
And Ryan sent the demo to Jeff Travis, who heard it, and a minute and a half into the first song, he called up Ryan and said, like, I want to work with these guys.
He played me down the telephone, Modern Age. And after about 10 seconds of hearing the guitar opening of Modern Age, I interrupted him and said, this is fantastic, I definitely want to put this out. And then, you know, he laughed, then he sent me the 3 tracks, which the Strokes had done as a demo themselves, thinking it was just a demo. And we heard it, Jeanette and I, and then we immediately flew to New York to meet the Strokes. They were playing anyway at a tiny little club out of town, about an hour and a half out of the city, and it was just a normal night. Lots of, you know, ordinary beer drinking suburban Americans were there, had no idea who was playing, and we were just amazed by them.
Albert Hammond Jr.
We spent about 2 years playing the New York circuit until that fateful Christmas, you know, where we sent the tape to Jeff Travis, and we didn't even know who he was. We thought like they were lying to us, like they were just like trying to scam us.
They didn't really know whether to believe us or not. And although they'd kind of heard of Rough Trade, probably some distant thing, there was an element of, are these people a couple of chances, you know, just talking nonsense? And we knew that we had to kind of demonstrate that we were serious about what we were saying. And what we said to them was, what we'd like to do is put out the Modern Age EP in England straight away, and we want to bring you over to tour. And let us show you our office and show you the people that we work with and demonstrate to you what we can do.
England? You want us to send us to England? I mean, is that real? I mean, does that work? We're like, okay.
Fantastic, but I do think that there's a lot resting on the shoulders, you know?
They're just really sexy and they're really rock and roll and they're like bringing punk rock back to the masses. And I shag them all, definitely.
If there's like 10 kids out there that's seen that, they start bands and pick up guitars and do it with a bit of energy and a bit of an edge, then fair play to them.
Is this it? The Strokes are it?
When the Strokes played, it was like pandemonium. It was like the pictures from the Beatles that you see from the 60s and stuff.
Hey, this is Albert, and you're listening to The Strokes on Radio 1. Have a nice day.
Well, I'm Nick. I play guitar in a band called The Strokes. And we are in Brighton, a nice little venue called The Pavilion.
How did it look through your eyes from the stage, or how did it feel?
pretty chaotic, I guess. It was rather intense. It was like the first show of the tour, like a huge room full of sweaty young English kids who I've never met in my life.
I remember them walking into the hall and it was packed with people. And Nick turned to me and said, "This is just unbelievable. You know, I thought we'd come to England and I thought there'd be no one there." And, you know, and that's how it started, really.
It's pretty surreal, actually. It still feels like a dream, sort of. We haven't really gotten used to the whole concept of playing sold-out tours.
In the audience at those early shows, Noel Gallagher.
The most important band since my band, I suppose, really, because they inspire a load of kids to pick up guitars like Johnny Thunders and all that when they came to London in the 70s and inspired the Sex Pistols. And all the bullshit the media's writing last year about this new music, it's going to happen.
I encourage people to not believe that we are the next big thing or that we're the best band to come out of New York in so-and-so years, or I don't even know what they say. Just sort of see for yourself and either pick up a record or come to a show, but don't believe the hype, as they say.
Jay Maskis from Dinosaur Jr. also checked them out.
Oh, I liked it. Really liked the singer. I thought he was cool. They just seem like a band, I guess. You know, they all contribute something, and, you know, the singer's really good. And they just have songs, and they just keep it moving, I think.
After this tour, many different things could happen. We're just sort of waiting for the right one.
Prophetic words indeed. The ensuing 12 months saw The Strokes release that demo on Rough Trade. They then hit the road with a vengeance, as Albert explains.
January, England. February, tour with Guided by Voices. March, whole tour of America, the first time ever with the Doves. Big thing, then South by Southwest, which got us, like, the buzz started roaring, you know? And then in April, we were like, let's not go on this back on the road to England, let's record the record now. Recorded in April and 2 weeks in May. Did a residency in Philadelphia and Boston in May, switching off Wednesdays and Saturdays. June, July, August of that year, world tour. Britain, parts of Europe, Australia, parts of the West Coast of America, and then back home.
The summer saw the band make their first festival appearances.
When did you first get a sense that it was this beast that could actually run and run?
When someone cancelled Tea in the Park, and they said they could squeeze us in the spot, you want to do it? And then they got organized where we had to charter a private plane to get there, if not we wouldn't make it. It's a propeller plane. Don't think it's like those fancy plane. It wasn't that much money. It's a really scary Indiana Jones kind of plane. And we flew from Kristiansand, Norway to Scotland, got right off the plane into a bus for an hour and a half to the place, went right on stage. Like, didn't even go to the dressing room. Like, right on stage from the bus, played the show, back on the bus, back on the plane to Mallorca. And I thought, like, holy shit. That's like a rock and roll story right there.
By the time of the Reading Festival at the end of that summer, though, Strokes mania had set in. The organisers were forced to move them out of the small tent and onto the big stage because of the demand. Here's Julian.
Reading, the most nervous I've ever been. I don't think we just feel like we're just going to go out and play some songs and, you know, then we're going to go party or go to sleep or whatever it is. I think for us, right before we get on stage, it's like, you know, the moment of truth. Then, you know, we want to go out there and we want to, like, move people.
It was quite a weekend because it also saw the release of the debut album, Is This It? The media may have gone into overdrive, but the Strokes were unperturbed. They had, at long last, achieved their ambition. Is this it? Here's Fab.
There was a very distinct moment when we were recording the album. We had all these songs together and they were in this like fucking cool package. We were all looking about saying like, who knows, this is no longer a dream of ours or us trying to handle something that's sort of obscure, which is playing a song every now and then at a bar. It's like a concrete thing that you can hold and you can play back. And if it doesn't make you sick, then maybe we're onto something.
So back here in New York City, it's the morning after the night before. With a fistful of awards and a couple of million record sales under their belt, the Strokes came home to celebrate in style at Radio City Music Hall. For my part, I bumped into their guru, J.P. Bowersock, whose photo you may have noticed on the album sleeve alongside those of the band themselves. A man who, to my knowledge, doesn't do interviews, but a man who has been party to everything they've done since their very early days. I think what I'm saying is that if there's one person with the inside track, then he's the man.
Hiya, Danny. Listen, JP wants to talk. Now, he doesn't really do interviews, but if you're okay with it, then he's happy to meet you at the hot dog stand in Tompkins Square Park about 11 this morning.
I'm JP Bowersock. I work with the Strokes as their guitar teacher and a bit more. The term they got for it is guru. And we're sitting in Tompkins Square Park in New York City right now on a Friday afternoon. Albert and I use the same guitar tech, Richie Baxt, here in New York City. And Albert had asked Richie if he knew anyone who could give him blues guitar lessons. Richie gave him my number because blues is one of my big passions.
He would just hang out with us and we'd play for an hour, do the lesson, and then we would just sit around drinking beers and talking about music history, and he would like teach us like all this stuff about music. I had no idea like what it was and how it all came together.
So I'd been doing two or three lessons with Albert, showing him a bunch of blues stuff and phrasing. And Julian lives there, and he was overhearing the lessons, and he finally said, can I take a couple of lessons from you? That was where I first got introduced to the music they were working on, the fact that they had a band. You know, I'd heard them talking about it.
And when it came to recording, you know, he came with us too. I want everyone who could help, you know, that I trusted to give their opinions, you know, and he also has a little bit of technical knowledge.
Most of the time, I'm just the wall he bounces ideas off of. He'd be in the midst of arranging something and frustrated because he wasn't able to come up with a part or whatever. And sometimes he and I would just brainstorm. I'd play him ideas off the top of my head, and then he'd take an idea he had and reworked it until he came up with a part that, to him, sounded cool.
Taught us a lot of stuff, you know, how like saying more with fewer notes and that kind of thing.
Some of the parts I gave Julian the basic kernel of an idea for, reworked, ended up on the record. A couple of tunes on there where I'm like, I remember working that out with Julian, you know?
That's a nice warm feeling, I would imagine.
Yeah, it feels great. Some people who know by playing actually hear the record and recognize one or two things that were obvious, you know?
Nikolai again.
Every time we would play a show, he would actually come and watch and sort of tell us individually what we were either doing right or wrong. And we're very lucky to have had someone like that, because many people either keep going thinking they're so good or whatever, and he's very to the point and honest, you know, you played that wrong, you played that bad.
Looking over last night's gig, tell me what you thought of it. You must have seen hundreds of Stroke shows.
It's a cool place to do a show, you know? If you have a band together and you can play Radio City Music Hall, you're going to do it. It's a beautiful place. It was totally worthwhile for them to do it, and it was a great show. I was psyched to hear the new songs dovetailing into the set so well. I thought Julian's voice was in great form too, which I know he was totally bummed out about having to sit through most of the show because his knees screwed up. So the fact that his voice was in such good form that it didn't matter that he was sitting down, that's great. the band is tighter now too. The arrangements are really shining, and that's great to hear. You know, they're on their way to just becoming an even better band, and I think the show last night showed that off.
So, from the man who nurtured the Strokes in their infancy, to a last word from the man who propelled them onto the worldwide stage, MD of Rough Trade Records, Jeff Travis.
The White Stripes and the Strokes, I mean, they both are really symbolic of a renaissance of a kind of fundamentalist, primal, wonderful rock and roll music. But I believe in rock and roll. I don't see why it has to necessarily fade away, and it won't if young people can practice it with the same kind of verve and vigor that the Strokes and the White Stripes do. So I think the two of them coming together is really quite a special moment in rock and roll history.
I don't think there's anything else you'd need to know. Thank you very much to Danny O'Connor for tonight's documentary on the Strokes.